Good evening. Thank you for tuning in to TV Marywood's Town Hall, Forming a More Perfect Union, the third installment in TVM's Town Hall series. Tonight's topic, environmental issues. This broadcast is sponsored by the Pacers for Justice and Peace and brought to you by the Marywood Media Group. I'm Alex Weiner, and I'll be your moderator for tonight's program. As always, we're joined by three guest panelists. We have Bill Kern, Countryside Conservancy Executive Director, Emily Rinaldi, the Northeastern Pennsylvania Outreach Coordinator for PennFuture, and lastly, we have Rabbi Daniel Swartz, a spiritual leader at Scranton's Temple Hesed, and you've been working with in the environment from an interfaith standpoint since the 1980s, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. All right. On our right, we have our audience, as always. They have submitted questions for our guest panelists to answer. We'll be going to them throughout the program. Thank you, everyone, for being with us tonight. We'll be live streaming on Facebook. Tonight's topic, as I said, environmental issues. We'd like to start our program with some of the topics we'll be discussing. Questions for tonight are going to focus on the Environmental Protection Agency, climate science, governmental environmental work, and local environmental issues. Before we go to our questions, Congressman Matt Cartwright held a town hall for constituents of Pennsylvania's 17th district last week in Pittston. Reporters from Marywood's online news source, The Woodward, asked Cartwright his thoughts on President Trump's plans for the EPA. Let's hear from Congressman Cartwright.
President Trump has proposed a cut to the EPA of a little more than 30%, which is a massive cut. The EPA is the enforcement agency in charge of enforcing the protections for our clean air and our clean water. And when you take away the people who enforce those things, what are you going to end up with? You're going to end up with polluted air and polluted water, and people are going to get sick. And my fellow member of the House Appropriations Committee, Charlie Dent, from Allentown, he's a Republican, he said, remember this, the president proposes, but the Congress disposes. In other words, it's up to us. Not the president, what goes into the budget.
As Congressman Cartwright said, the decisions made by this administration and by this Congress will influence the future of our environment. The three of you have knowledge and experience working with environmental issues. Can you briefly explain that background and how you got interested in environmental work? We can start with Bill.
Sure. So I'm born and raised in Northeast Pennsylvania, from Tunkhannock. Just got to start just with the environmental ethic of respect, just from my parents. Nothing, you know, too tree huggery, but you know, just made me respect you know, what it is that we had. And as I went on to college up in Ithaca, New York, I got more interested in environmental issues, which then led me to graduate work at Brown University in environmental studies. Again, I just kept coming back to the same sense of responsibility, you know, to the environment, and that led me to my current role at Countryside Conservancy as the executive director of the nonprofit land trust.
Okay, thank you. Emily?
I was born and raised in Troop, Pennsylvania, and my high school teachers got me involved in a couple of different externships at DCNR and the state parks around here, and then which led me to go to Keystone College for in Bachelor's of Science in Environmental Resource Management. I worked in the Pennsylvania Conservation District area for about 3 years, and I wanted to educate people more and bring more outreach to this area, so which led me to my current role as the Northeast Outreach Coordinator for PennFuture.
Okay, and Rabbi Daniel.
I've been involved with nature since I was a little kid. I just always loved exploring. When I was a Boy Scout, we had this contest to identify winter trees, and some of the other kids in the troop thought it was cool that I knew them, and they said, and I said, you know, actually I'm much better with rocks. So for 10 years my nickname was Rocks. And I went to Brown as an undergrad and majored in environmental studies, and as I was there, I began to really connect the environment up with my faith and the development of my faith as a Jew, and have really try to make that an emphasis in the work that I've done ever since then, both in congregations and with a variety of interfaith organizations that have worked on the environment, looking at everything from the children's health in the environment to climate change.
Okay, thank you. Now we're going to go to our first question for tonight from Caitlin Korjeski.
Thank you. My first question is, what is the first step in saving the environment?
It's a good place to start. We can start with Daniel.
Adel Leopold, one of the great conservationists who also grew up in Wisconsin, said that you won't love what you don't know, and you won't protect what you don't love. So the very first step is to understand that the world around us is so important to all of our life. I often ask audiences when I'm speaking to close their eyes and think of the first word that comes to their mind or first image when they think of environment. And then I ask them to raise their hands if there are any people in that picture. And there almost never are. And people think that the environment's something out there. When you realize that this is where we live, this is where we work and play and learn and pray. And if the environment's not healthy, none of us are gonna be healthy. If the environment doesn't have a future, we don't have a future. Then that shifts. So that first step is just to realize, hey, this is really important. And then you speak up for its protection.
Emily?
Kind of bouncing off what he said, people understanding why the environment is important, having an agreement between groups that it is important for many different reasons. Perfect example, environmental issues are kind of like a river. So I'm the state lead for the Delaware, Coalition for the Delaware River Watershed. And people in Pike County and Wayne County in our area are worried about the river because it's beautiful. It's a place to go fishing. It's a place to vacation. Where once you get down into Philadelphia, people are worried about that river because it's their drinking water. So you have to understand that everything flows downstream, which is a quote that's used many a times. But these environmental issues, there needs to be an agreement, a reason for people to understand why they need to protect it.
Okay. And Bill?
Totally in agreement with Daniel as far as making that connection between people and their environment. At our land trust, you know, we do our best to open our properties up, you know, to the public, to get them out there, to provide opportunities, you know, whether they be recreational or what have you, you know, to get people out and to connect, you know, with nature and that there are so many different ways, you know, to approach those relationships, you know, with the environment, and that, you know, we all play a role, you know, in taking care and being stewards of the environment.
Okay, thank you. We'll be taking a short break, but when we return, more from TVM's Town Hall, forming a more perfect union.
Paying off all those student loans.
Finally, right?
How'd you manage that anyway?
I started tracking my spending, changed a couple of habits.
Wow. I'm kind of living paycheck to paycheck right now. I don't even know how I'm doing it.
Well, have you tried saving a little?
I want to, but where's that money gonna come from? Bill collectors, they're the worst. Am I right?
When it comes to financial stability, don't get left behind.
Not home.
Get tools and tips for saving at feedthepig.org.
Oh! Checking your fantasy league?
Nah, just my 401k statement.
Nice. Where'd you find the money for that?
I've just been saving a little every month.
I can't seem to save anything.
Well, what about all this? What about the money you're spending?
What money? It's gone before I can get my hands on it.
I got a pizza for a Todd.
Hey, can somebody spot me?
When it comes to financial stability, don't get left behind.
It's 547.
Get tools and tips for saving at feedthepig.org.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit the shelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
Forming a more perfect union on environmental issues. We'll be taking our second question of the night from our live studio audience. This one comes from Tatiana Tell.
What can we do as American citizens to acknowledge and raise awareness about global warming in the world when our very own leader doesn't?
Okay. We can start with Emily this time and go either way.
So first off, instead of using the term global warming, I would like to use climate change. PennFuture is a huge advocate for educating people on climate change, so I'd like to stick with that. As you can tell from the Science March and also the Climate March coming up on Saturday, there is a huge amount of people who already understand this, whether our leader does or not. And as you could tell from what CNN said, there was a march in London, in Germany, in Switzerland, in the United States, many different places. It's not just the United States. Pretty much the biggest thing I think we can do is, even if you are not getting paid to be an environmental advocate, find a place where you can volunteer for the environment, find places where you can go and reach out to other people who might not understand it. And if you happen to be out and hear people talking about it, you don't want to push them down, you want to educate them so that you could bring them up to the level that you're on, and hopefully that'll leak upwards this time.
Okay. Who wants to go next? Bill?
Oh, yeah. I think demanding that our representatives, our elected leaders, address climate change, acknowledge it, and do something about it. Just last Saturday, Countryside Conservancy co-hosted a film over at the Dietrich Theater in Tunkhannock. And it was called Before the Flood. It's a National Geographic documentary with Leonardo DiCaprio. And we actually had a Marywood professor, Dr. Sarah Kenahan, who did a little Q&A afterwards. But one of the things in the movie that really struck me was the comment, and I forget who made it, but that we don't elect leaders, we elect followers. And you see, you know, that Trump is representative of, you know, the attitudes and opinions of, while not the majority of the country, a pretty good, you know, chunk of the country. So, you know, it's up to us to educate ourselves, educate our neighbors, our friends, and to coalition build and to demand representation from our leaders that they actually do something about climate change.
Okay, Daniel?
And I think it's especially important for you as college students to get involved in this, because especially with issues like climate change, the carbon dioxide that we pollute up into the atmosphere today will be around for about 100 years. That's its half-life of remaining up there. So people who are in generations before you are creating big problems for you. And by the time you get out in the world, there are going to be problems that we haven't addressed that you're going to have to figure out what to do something about. So don't wait. Speak up now. Educate people. When you talk to people and they say things like, well, the science isn't clear, actually, that's not true. If you're a climate scientist, you understand that there's climate change going on. There's a lot of smoke and mirrors, so to speak. But the reality is our planet's already warming, our climate is changing, and there are people whose lives are ruined because of that already. So make sure to be loud.
Okay. Our next question is going to come from Elizabeth Carlson.
How can we encourage and start cleanup projects throughout Scranton? There are many areas in need, and it can be a Better Together and VIA-run event, but we need participants and students willing to contribute their time and effort.
Okay. Billy, would you like to start?
Well, I would actually kick it over to Emily, just with your experience with Seeds. I know that they had a lot of community engagement as far as projects like that go. Would that be something you could...
Right. So Seeds of Northeastern Pennsylvania is actually a solar group. It's a sustainable sustainable energy and solar group out of Honesdale. So besides just them, I've been on the board of the Northeast Audubon Society for 2 years now. Them, LRCA, which is the Lackawanna River Corridor, PennFuture likes to help with things like that, EPCAMR that's out of, Ashley. There's many environmental groups around here. So maybe going and talking to them, researching a little bit more, and finding those localized groups. Riverfest, that's run every year, that's coming up on, I believe it's May 13th, is a huge event. They do a cleanup in the river, they do the, a kayaking event. Partnering with those groups, and honestly, that's kind of what partial of my job is. If groups need to come to me and look, and I can partner you up with people, and groups that would be able to help you in localized territory.
Yeah, that idea of trying to build coalitions and working with other people is really key. And don't forget religious organizations. The The Order of Nuns, that the IHM sisters that run Marywood, have a very strong environmental policy, and they have done a number of publications on the environment. I'm kind of like an honorary IHM nun because I've written so many things for their publications. The diocese of Scranton has a person, Richard DeBona, who's working on social justice issues and wants to get people involved on the environment. This Saturday, the 29th, at the same time that there's going to be the climate march down in D.C., Lackawanna River Conservation Association is going to be having an event in town, and we're going to be doing kind of a mini sister march where we're going to the river and blessing it. So coming to things like that, getting involved with those organizations, asking questions, and Emily knows everybody, so you just ask her. We should put her contact information up on Facebook, and folks should just get connected.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We're going to take another short break, but more of TVM's Town Hall when we come back.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit the shelterpetproject.org. Adopt. There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit the shelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
I dare you.
I dare you to change the world.
Yeah, you. Getting that college education.
I dare you to be somebody important.
Like be a teacher.
Or a reality TV star.
I dare you to stand up here.
To call the shots.
To be a role model.
An inspiration.
An innovator.
To be a teacher.
Think you can change my life?
Make me excited about science like you?
Have a career that really means something?
Then do it.
I dare you.
Good evening. I'm Alex Widener. Welcome back to TV Marywood's Town Hall. Tonight's topic, environmental issues. I'm joined by Bill Kern, the Countryside Conservancy Executive Director, Emily Rinaldi, the Northeastern Pennsylvania Outreach Coordinator for PennFuture, and Rabbi Daniel Swartz, a spiritual leader at Temple Hesed, who has been working on environmental issues from an interfaith standpoint since the 1980s. Thank you all again for joining us tonight, and thank you to our audience. Our next question for tonight, got a little bit of background to start off with. The Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection confirmed a leachate spill at the Keystone Sanitary Landfill after heavy rainfall in February. What do you think is a good way to deal with the environmental impact pollution has in our local community?
So when I was between college and rabbinical school, I was a nanny. And at that point, there was this cartoon on called Captain Planet. And while Ted Turner has done many great things for the environment, I'm not sure that I would list Captain Planet with them, because the whole premise was that there were people who like enjoyed polluting, wah-ha-ha-ha-ha kind of thing. And that's not really how it works. People pollute because they can make a greater profit by polluting unless someone enforces that and stops it. And so we have to look at who's in power and who's has the power to enforce safety and health regulations. DEP's Department of Environmental Protection in Pennsylvania, their budget has been slashed. A big part of that has been the enforcement people. They can't get around. The folks who are running things like the landfills are big political contributors, and often people don't want to upset them or cut in on their things. Hey, listen, I'm fine for you to make a profit, but I don't want you to make a profit based on hurting other people. And that's what environmental protection's about.
Just to add to that, so the way that the environmental regulatory system works in Pennsylvania, there's DEP, which is the state, and then you also have your conservation districts that are down to your county level. Most people some people don't remember that they can call on their conservation districts, and they have inspectors that if DEP isn't getting out there, they can call on them, and then they'll be able to report back to DEP to maybe get a foot on the ground a couple days sooner than DEP can get an inspector out. And then on top of that, when big pollution events like that are happening and you're very concerned about it, you know, giving a phone call or a visit to your House of Representatives office in your district or your senator, or calling and bugging people on the political spectrum that would be able to help or make sure that something gets done. So
I think that reaching out to your representatives is also a really significant way. Whether it's writing a letter to them, whether it's phone call, email, going and visiting them. Some representatives, maybe they're proactive and they want to hear from you and therefore they will act. Other ones, they just they don't want to be publicly shamed, or they don't want the backlash of constituents out there. So it really is it's the way that you are able to get things done. One of the ways. So that would be, my recommendation would be your public officials.
Okay, thank you. After another short break, we'll return with more of our discussion. Stay tuned.
I dare you.
I dare you to change the world.
Yeah, you. Getting that college education.
I dare you to be somebody important.
Like be a teacher.
Or a reality TV star.
I dare you to stand up here.
To call the shots.
To be a role model.
An inspiration.
An innovator.
To be a teacher.
Think you can change my life?
Make me excited about science like you?
Have a career that really means something?
Then do it.
I dare you.
What this place needs is better graduation rates.
What this place needs is less childhood obesity.
What this place needs is free help with taxes.
What this place needs is healthy breakfasts.
What this place needs is fitness programs for kids.
What this place needs is early readers.
What this place needs is mentors for teens.
What this place needs is people to join us. What this place needs is you. To donate or volunteer, go to unitedway.org.
You know what, guys? There's a lot of tree branches and dry brush over here. We should probably move the bonfire over there.
I'm guessing Smokey liked that idea.
Welcome back to the TVM Town Hall, Environmental Issues. Let's get right back into the questions. I have another one for our panelists here. After the confirmed leachate spill we mentioned earlier, what are your thoughts on the continued use of landfills and the growing problems that waste disposal has caused in Pennsylvania? Bill?
Yeah, I'd be happy to weigh in on that. I think it raises a lot of issues, but like with everything, there is a right and a wrong way to do it. I mean, we have more than one landfill in this area, and despite what you might think about the visuals of it, there's one landfill that seems to be doing things much better than the other one. So, there is a way to do a better job. But then the other thing is, what are we doing? Why are we setting ourselves up as a state to be, the acceptor of waste from other states, for profit purposes? What do we want for this area? Do we want to send the message that we're everyone's dumping ground, or do we want to invest in other things and encourage other things and limit, for example, the height of the landfill in the area, and also the proximity, to the city? As much as I represent Countryside Conservancy, I'm not suggesting that we move all the waste out into the countryside, it does kind of boggle my mind, to have these giant mountains of waste within, visual eyesight of the city ground. So, I think asking what do we want as a region.
Right, Emily, do you have anything to add?
I actually completely agree with deal with that and the regulatory standards and making sure your voice is heard if you don't want to walk out your door and look at the mountain that's outside your window that's really just trash. That's also not just trash from this area, but coming in from other states. What do you want to see the landscape of Pennsylvania and northeastern Pennsylvania specifically look like in the next 20 years for your kids to see and your grandkids to see? And then from there, that's when you try and get regulatory reinforcement and talk to your representatives once again. Talk to your local governments, also to your townships, people who are approving these. How do you want to say, either extensions or expansions of landfills?
Right. And the only thing I'd add to that is the responsibility of consumers. So landfills exist because we create lots of waste. And there are things we can do to cut down on that waste, cutting down on food waste, on plastic waste, in terms of what kinds of things we buy. You know, buy yourself a water bottle, refill it. And don't go to the store and keep getting bottled water. All sorts of ways that we can be not creating that waste in the first place. And ultimately, that's where we need to be going as a society.
Okay. And just sort of to add to that, we'll go each of you individually on a scale of, say, 1 to 10. How would you rate Scranton's sort of environmental efforts and the state of the environment in Scranton? You can start with Daniel.
We just got a passing grade on air, which is a fabulous thing, but part of that is because the economy is having so much trouble. So we'd love to have both a booming economy and clean enough manufacturing that we don't return to the bad old days of coal. I think there's a growing awareness. The Lackawanna River has definitely been cleaned up, but with the encroachment of fracking in our area, with the landfill issues, we've got some serious challenges.
Just to kind of add to that, so Scranton as a city itself, it has been doing a lot of efforts. I've seen a lot more awareness, and as Rabbi Swartz said, to clean up. So my personal territory expands to 19 counties across northeastern Pennsylvania. And there is complete different issues all over that territory, but I have seen a change since the administration of the federal government changed, that there is a extreme raised awareness for people who want to better the area, and a large awareness for this area that I call home. So happy to see that.
Okay, Bill?
I think that, I mean, historically, you know, with the history of coal and steel, I mean, you know, the air quality, the water quality, the pollution that existed in the past, you know, we would have clocked in around a 2 or 3 on your 1 to 10 scale. But, you know, I think that we're creeping up, and we're definitely on the upswing as far as awareness and efforts go. So, you know, say 5, 6, maybe, you know, hitting the 7 mark. That being said, there's a lot of opportunity, you know, for improvements to be made. As Daniel said, you know, because of some of the waning, you know, industry, you know, that we don't have as much pollution, you know, maybe as we used to in some areas, but we have a lot of opportunity to capitalize on the natural beauty of the area to increase things like tourism and outdoor recreation. So, you know, thinking about those opportunities and as a way to capitalize on our clean air and clean water.
Okay. Thank you. Our next question from the audience is going to come from Travis Murray.
So, what sort of renewable energy source or sources would you propose as the most efficient for small business owners or homeowners to use locally to try to benefit themselves both financially and the environment?
Okay, so question about renewable energy sources.
I could start off.
Okay, yeah. Sure.
So most recently. Pennsylvania DEP and PennFuture was actually granted by the Department of Energy a $500,000 grant for a Finding Pennsylvania Solar Future. So a big issue in Pennsylvania with trying to put solar panels on your roof is that there's trees everywhere, right? And also too, where Pennsylvania is actually located on the planet, you don't get as direct sun rays as if we lived in the Midwest, so it makes it a little bit harder, and most people don't see the payoff for solar panels. So what this program's trying to do is almost come up with different types of community solar ideas, where maybe putting solar panels on a telephone pole, or is putting solar panels, making solar farms, giving farmers who aren't growing crops as well or anything, you could farm solar now. Also trying to create jobs by taking maybe coal miners and gas drillers and people who are looking for a more sustainable job and train them in installing solar and more sustainable energy uses. So for the next 30 months, Pennsylvania DEP and PennFuture, plus over 160 stakeholders that showed up to our first meeting in March, are trying to come up with an energy plan to get approved by the federal government in order to bring Pennsylvania and find our solar future to bring up to over 10% by 2030. So on top of that, something that you could do now, there is a program called the Power to Switch. And in Pennsylvania, the residents have the power to choose where their energy comes from. You could go to the Power to Switch website. PennFuture also has a link. We have it on our website. And you can actually choose that to have 100% renewable energy coming into your house. And you would still have your normal PP&L bill or whatnot, but you're choosing where your energy comes from and what you're paying for. So there's ways to do that now. And also to, if you have the money and the territory to put solar panels on your roof, that could benefit you in the long run. Also to cutting down on your recyclables, cutting down on human use to begin with. That'll also help you in energy efficiency ways in the long run.
Okay, Daniel?
Emily covered almost everything I was gonna say, which is great. Just to step up a little on the conservation side, you know, the most energy efficient, the most sustainable form of energy right now is to not use in the first place. So putting in LED light bulbs, having smart thermostats, that power to switch is a great thing. What we do when we try to get our electricity from wind sources or solar sources is we help build those industries. And as those industries get built up, they get economies of scale and it gets cheaper and cheaper and cheaper. So you can make that decision as a consumer right now that I wanna pay maybe a tiny bit more for my power bill, but to create a better future for the planet. And that's a great thing to do.
Okay, Bill?
I think for business owners or residential owners, if they have an existing structure, I think one of the best things that they can do is initially reach out to a firm that would do an energy audit, on their structure. So they'll use thermal imaging, to see, are you just hemorrhaging, heat coming off your building in the middle of winter time, and then addressing it, with insulation. So, again, not wasting that energy to begin with, and addressing it before it even, happens, becomes a problem, and then start looking into, other options, specifically solar, also geothermal. I know a lot of people that have begun utilizing geothermal as a very effective, renewable means of heating and cooling their house or their business. But as far as like if new construction goes, certainly entertaining how solar can be built into your new structure and geothermal as well.
Okay, thank you. It's time for another short break, but when we come back, we'll have more of our questions for our panelists. Stay tuned.
You know what, guys? There's a lot of tree branches and dry brush over here. We should probably move the bonfire over there.
I'm guessing Smokey liked that idea.
You've messed up your son's haircut.
Mom?
Do you A, try to fix it?
Like it never happened.
B, work with what you got? Or C, show solidarity?
Thank you, babe.
As a parent, there are no perfect answers. But you don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. thousands of teens in foster care will love you just the same.
This is the story of a boy who is very sensitive to lights and sounds. So he built secret hiding places where nothing could get in. The boy didn't like looking people in the eye. It made him feel uncomfortable. One day, he found out he had something called autism. His family got him help. And slowly, he learned how to live with it better.
Early intervention can make a lifetime of difference. Learn the signs at autismspeaks.org.
They said I have troll teeth.
That my voice sounded like a possessed baby doll.
That no one would ever love someone as stupid as me.
That I was fat. Ugly.
Disgusting.
The effect of bullying is potent.
We will no longer be the silent majority.
Now, when you see online bullying, there's something you can do about it.
We're gonna take action with the eye.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness.
I am a witness, and so are you.
Alvin and the Chipmunks want to remind you, bacteria can hide in food and make you ill.
Wow.
But you can keep bacteria from ruining your day with four simple steps. Clean.
I'm waiting for the rinse cycle.
Separate. Cook.
Fire in the hole.
And chill.
We chipmunks are notoriously tidy.
Check your steps. The road trip to food safety starts at foodsafety.gov.
Welcome back to TVM Town Hall, Environmental Issues. I'm your host tonight, Alex Widener. Our guest panelists tonight are Emily Rinaldi, the Northeastern Pennsylvania Outreach Coordinator for PennFuture, Rabbi Daniel Swartz, a spiritual leader at Scranton's Temple Hesed, and the are you former or current Associate Director of the National Religious Partnership?
Former. I'm currently a board president of Pennsylvania Interfaith Power and Light, which is a volunteer position.
Okay. And we have Bill Kern, Executive Director of the Countryside Conservancy. And as always, our live studio audience to my right. Thanks for tuning in. Our next question is going to come from Rachel Eiler.
My question is, with Scott Pruitt as head of the EPA and this administration's approach to the climate change, what do you think the impact on our planet will be?
Okay. Who would like to start?
Bill? I'll go ahead. I think it's just really unfortunate that a lot of the progress that we've made is attempting to be dismantled, you know, from the president down to his appointee, Scott Pruitt. We have a secretary, that is known for suing the EPA and trying to get them to do less and to be less involved and to turn more responsibility back over to the states, which it just doesn't make any sense. I mean, it's the whole reason that the EPA was created is that, you know, we need to address these things on a larger scale, you know, that what happens in California impacts people in the Midwest and impacts people in the Northeast. So, you know, the whole point is that we need a federal level, for regulating our air and our water. I don't think that all hope is lost, though. Believe it or not, I think China is actually something that we could, look at as something, positive, in the sense that they went from, they think they still are the number one, CO2 emitter, but they are quickly and rapidly changing and advancing in renewable energy because they see the economic sense that it makes, and they see, how bad their air has become. They, for better or worse, they have the ability to change, quickly, and they are making it happen. And if we can, continue to encourage that and try to get India, to follow suit, it's just tough to not look really hypocritical when we are the number one, energy user per person in the world, for us to not be leading on it. But it doesn't mean that all hope is lost.
Okay, Emily?
I completely agree with the not all hope is lost, but getting rid of that federal group where, the EPA was created during former President Nixon's terms, and it wasn't for any political reason at all. It was to better this country, and also, too, laws and things that EPA comes with trickles down into the states, and it's almost like DEP's grandmother that leads them through, and then that trickles down to your county conservation districts and your localized townships. All the money, all the economics, everything trickles down from that federal level. And unfortunately, having someone who doesn't believe in climate change and things like that, if it even came to the point where it talks the administration into getting backing out of the Paris Agreement, I mean, that could lead to tariffs, that can lead to countries not wanting to do economic business with this country because they don't believe that we want to better the entire planet. This Paris Agreement was for the entire world. It's not just for localized here. So it is very unfortunate putting people who don't understand why the EPA is supposed to be there, pretty much, or not agreeing with why they're supposed to be there. It's very unfortunate, and it could lead to many issues down the road for politically, economically, environmentally, many different reasons.
Okay. Rabbi Daniel?
They've covered most of it, but I want to add two things. The first is just to build on a point that Bill said, which is, Scott Pruitt is the head of the EPA. We're not in a monarchy. He's not king. We can oppose what he does, and we have to. And there are many different ways to oppose that, but all of them start with being informed and speaking up. And the more we can stop the bad things that he is trying to do, the better off our planet will be. There's this basic religious concept of what protection is, and it's the idea that you value other people and that you value them all because we're all part of God's world. And Scott Pruitt, that's not there in his vocabulary. So we have to be raising those issues again and again and again. But I want to also say something that what Congressman Cartwright said at the beginning. He emphasized one part of EPA, and there's a lot more than that. He talked about EPA as the enforcer, but EPA is where a lot of the science gets done. Mm-hmm. EPA is where folks come together to think of solutions. EPA is where we come up with ideas about, we've designed all these regulations to protect the health of healthy, white, middle-aged men, and amazingly enough, not our entire country is made up of them. And so maybe we need to look at issues that affect women's health, that affect children's health. All of that came out of the work of EPA. And if we throw that out, we're all in a lot more trouble. One more piece of something that the Trump administration is trying to change is this arcane thing called the discount rate, which basically says each year in the future, money or benefits in that year are worth less than they are in the present. And there's some good economic reasons for doing that in some things, but for a lot of life, that's basically saying, in 10 years, you're worth half as much as you are today. And I hope most people don't feel that's reality. And the Trump administration wants to raise that discount rate, which essentially makes every year in the future worth less and less and less and less. And as they do that, they're going to be promoting ideas that steal from the future, that get profit in the present and cause problems for generations to come. And we've got to stop them from doing that.
Okay. Do you think there's any positivity that could come from sort of state-based environmental agencies taking the lead in any aspect of, environmental protection and climate science types of ordeals? Phil?
That's tricky. I mean, I think we're such a large nation, especially compared to, like European countries, for example, that we have places like Miami, Florida, that are firsthand experiencing the effects of climate change. So, it might make sense, for them because they are feeling it. They ought to be more passionate about it, for them to take the lead on pushing, these matters and getting the word out, to the rest of the country. I still think, though, that that the federal level approach is absolutely necessary, and even as Emily started to talk about, economically speaking, the problem with turning power back over to the states with these rules is that if different states have different requirements for levels of this or that in products, how is a manufacturer supposed to keep all of those things straight? How are they supposed to just make stuff for Pennsylvania and a different product for New York? Just economically speaking, it's important to have these overarching standards, across the country.
Sure. Emily?
Perfect example. So how is one state, so let me back up here as a good example. The Delaware River Basin is made up of 4 to 5 states, depending on how you look at it. If all 4 of those states had different regulations on what needed to go into that river, now mind you, you can go to Pike County and stand in Pennsylvania and look across the river and see New York. So is it okay to throw pollutants into the Pennsylvania side of the river and not in the New York side? Like, states need to work together in order to figure out how to make these things better. I mean, even not just climate change, water, air, everything that the environment has to do with ties into climate change. So watersheds depend on where, topographically, the water's running into the same flowing body of water. So how is one state supposed to not work with the other and still be able to come to the same effect, and then everything that runs into the bay or everything that runs into the ocean that now touches every single coastal state? I don't think it would be able to work correctly or efficiently. There needs to be a federal standard and a federal group looking over those states to make sure that they're working together for the same cause, and as a country working together as for the same cause.
Sure. All right, Daniel.
Another example like that is under President Bill Clinton, Carol Browner was the head of the EPA. And one of the things that she tried to do was to encourage states to get out in front and to innovate and to come up with ways to achieve the same ends in a way that was easier for the businesses in their state. So you can encourage that, but EPA still made sure that no one was trying to dive to the bottom and say, oh, come to our place because we're not protecting the environment, we're not protecting health, and so you can make more of a profit here, which is exactly what you don't want to have happen. So there are ways to have states lead in innovation where you still have basic protection so that you're understanding that everybody's life is valued and that the good world that we're blessed with is valued. And to say, well, you know, we're just going to turn it over to the states and we're going to look the other way is not the way to do it.
Okay, thank you. After another short break, we'll be back with our last questions and final remarks of the night.
There are 16 million children struggling with hunger in America. That's 1 in 5 daughters, sons, neighbors, and classmates who don't know where their next meal is coming from. Yet billions of pounds of good food go to waste every year. It's time we do something about it. Feeding America is a nationwide network of food banks that helps provide meals to millions of kids and families in need. Visit feedingamerica.org to help them feed even more. Together, we can solve hunger. Together, we're feeding America.
There's one thing you can never have sex without.
It's not something you buy.
Or something you take.
In fact, there's only one way to get it.
It has to be given to you, freely.
It's consent.
Because sex without it isn't sex.
It's rape. Consent.
If you don't get it, you don't get it.
It's on us to stop sexual assault.
Learn how and take the pledge at itsonus.org.
Doing great. We're going to try this again, okay?
Okay.
Wheels, pedals, handlebar, brakes. Sit up straight, keep your weight in the center, keep your eyes on the road, hands on the grips, button the seat. If we feel ourselves falling, what do?
Just keep pedaling.
Good girl. Now remember, it's all about balance and steering. Steer with your hands, steer with your body. Steer into the corners and you stay out of trouble. And the bell's your buddy, so go ahead and ding that. All right, ready? Here we go. Pedal, honey, pedal. Go, you're a bike rider.
Most parenting is hard to do in just 2 minutes. But 2 minutes twice a day making sure they brush is easier, and it could help save them from a lifetime of tooth pain.
Right, mi cariño. So like I said, everything I learned about cooking, I learned from grandma's empanadas. Shall we go again?
Yep.
Mix the beef with the onions with the peppers with the paprika, the garlic with the oregano with the cumin. Got it?
Got it.
Throw on the olive, stir, season, stir again, pour out the flour, roll out the dough, make a circle, drop in a fistful of filling, fold over, press down, and ta-da!
Most parenting is hard to do in just 2 minutes. But 2 minutes twice a day making sure they brush is easier, and it could help save them from a lifetime of tooth pain.
Thanks for tuning back into TVM's Town Hall, forming a more perfect union. For those just joining us, we have a live studio audience with us tonight, as well as our guest panelists. Our next question for tonight comes from James Cole.
What is the worst case scenario for the environment if the Trump administration keeps defunding programs like the EPA and stuff like that?
Okay. Would like to start, Rabbi Daniel?
You know, I try not to be a pessimist. I was saying to Emily and Bill earlier that I'm a third generation Cubs fan, so I like having hope. even when it might seem to the rest of the sane world to not have hope. But there's this very depressing and unfortunately fairly true saying in the environmental world, all of our victories are temporary and all of our defeats are permanent. You know, when a species goes extinct, it doesn't get unextinct. Jurassic World to the contrary. When you have coastal towns that are flooded, they don't magically get built back up. So the worst case scenario is that we end up doing so much climate pollution in the next 4 years that that people afterwards have that much harder time trying to stabilize the climate again. And that's going to be something that people will pay for generations. And we know from the geological past that there are times when the climate has shifted radically in a relatively brief period of time. If that happens, you know, the planet will still be here, there will still be many species, but civilization is a pretty thin fabric on our world. And when you had a drought that was prolonged in Syria, all of a sudden a country that was in trouble became a country that was in a civil war that hasn't ended. So those are the kinds of things that can happen.
Sure. Emily?
Perfect thing to think about, the decrease in food production, the decrease, there's a lot more to farming than most people think. There's the acidity of the soil, the soil quality, the amount of water, where are you going to get those irrigations? I mean, you can look at civilizations where, as Daniel just said, that there were civilizations centuries ago that would have to dig trenches from water sources, that was the person's job, is to go find water. Reverting back to those issues would not be good whatsoever. So the rate that climate change is happening is that the rate that the world's heating up. So there, it's not necessarily an how do I want to phrase this? It's not necessarily that it would have never happened. It's just the humans helping increase and all the CO2 going into the atmosphere and making that rate speed up. It's going to have a huge effect on agriculture, a huge effect on jobs and the economy once again. And I mean, every environmental victory grows the economy. So if we can fix the environment and have add solar panels to here and create possibly 3 million jobs across this country, or figure out different ways to do agriculture and to raise cows rather than emitting almost 80% through beef production of the CO2 and methane into the atmosphere, figuring out other ways to live sustainably. If we don't do that, then we're going to be reverting back to things when the world starts changing and heats up to where humans might not be able to exist.
Sure. Bill?
I think, worst case is that time is of the essence, and that we're missing out, you know, on opportunities, you know, to make the transition to a more, you know, renewable, sustainable society and economy. What I find most disheartening too is just the basics that we're slipping on, which is we're still debating in some people's minds, you know, is climate change real? Does it exist? And that's not where we need to be. We need to be at the point of, yes, it exists. Yes, it is anthropogenically influenced, human, you know, influenced. And what are the solutions and how are we implementing them? So, we've already kind of backtracked to this really basic argument that just really shouldn't even be happening. On the other end of it, though, I am an optimist as well. And I think that with the election, you know, of President Trump and everything that goes with it, I think it was a real eye-opener for everyone, I want to say, and recognizing that we do have a long way to go, but also that we can't be complacent, you know, that, things were marginally better and going in the right direction, you know, the previous 8 years, environmentally speaking, but it's still, we weren't on par with European countries. And So look at it as an opportunity to, get upset and focus, that negative energy on something positive and electing, better representatives in the future.
Okay. And what do you think students in particular can do to sort of, have an impact on the environment and have like a positive
sort of way to help this sort of issue?
I mean, this right here is fantastic, and I'm really glad that Marywood University is putting together, you know, forums, you know, like this to have these kinds of conversations. You know, informing yourselves, asking questions, you know, even you know, of your professors, you know, pushing them to give you more information. Also thinking about how to have these conversations with regular people, you know, so it's easy to kind of sit in a bubble and talk about these issues and you know, and discuss what solutions might be, but you know, when it comes to engaging with, you know, your average person in the real world, a lot of people just don't either have the time or they don't think that they have the time to discuss these things. So just trying to put yourself in other people's shoes and working on engaging folks, but without, you know, necessarily, you know, preaching or chastising them or making them feel bad. I mean, that it's really hard to do. I struggle with it, but you know, just being aware of that and trying, you know, your best to be on the same level as people and engage them.
Okay, Emily, do you have anything to add?
I completely agree. Educate yourself, educate your family, know your audience when you go to educate your neighbor. That's a motto that I live by. Know who you're talking to before you offend someone, because you don't want to turn them off from what you're trying to talk about. You want to figure out how to help them understand so that they want to educate themselves, educate their family, and pass it on.
Sure. Rabbi Daniel?
When you're in college, there's a lot of your environment that you're not in charge of. You can't turn down the thermostat because it's for a whole building. You're not the ones changing light bulbs. But there are a couple of things that you still can change in terms of your lifestyle. One is, you know, how often do you drive versus how often do you walk or take public transit? And the less you drive and the more you explore other means of getting around, the more likely you're living on the planet. And the second is how you eat. As Emily mentioned earlier, you know, beef production in particular has a slew of effects on the environment and particularly the climate. And I recommend a YouTube video called The Real Cost of a Hamburger. And after you look at that, you'll say, you know, maybe not so much. My wife and I, after seeing another very powerful film besides After the Flood, it's called Racing Extinction. And it looks at all the things we're doing in our planet that are causing extinction. And we came out crying about what we're doing to our planet. And we said, you know, let's at least decide on something right now. And we put ourselves on a red meat budget. 25 times a year we can have red meat, that's it. Which is not such a huge thing to do. It's not saying, oh, I can never have a steak and enjoy it. But it's saying, I have to think about it. I'm certainly not gonna go and have, if I'm limited to 25 times, I'm not gonna go and have a bad piece of meat. You know, I'm not gonna get fast food. You know, I'm just gonna, special occasions. And as I think more about what I'm eating, I can make choices that affect other people and affect our planet and take them into consideration. You know, and then I'm living more of the life that God wants me to live.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you again for joining us for tonight's TV Marywood Town Hall. Thank you to our panelists for being here. Thank you to our audience and those who submitted questions. And thank you to those of you watching at home. This has been the final installment in our series of the Town Hall for the spring 2017 semester. Stay tuned to TV Marywood's Facebook page for news and entertainment. And be sure to check out our Twitter and Instagram. On behalf of everyone here at TVM, I'm Alex Weiner. Thank you and good night.